Hello, everyone, and welcome to this channel. I am Nonya, your real estate tutoress. On this channel, I bring the best tips and tools to getting your real estate license. I also answer any questions you may have about the process. If you're new here, welcome, and do consider subscribing. As you prepare for the Illinois Broker Examination, there are certain terms and vocabulary you need to know in order to succeed. My goal in this video is to give you some of those terms. And when you finish this one, be sure to stay to the end, right? And then jump on to the next one, which is a similar vocabulary video. And be sure to check my page for other videos as well as you prepare for the examination. Now, the examination can be stressful to study for, but it is very, very doable, right? And so as I post videos, let me know in the comments if you need me to post on certain other topics. And any questions you have as you're preparing, feel free to ask. As I show you the definitions, some of the definitions I will show you will be sort of the textbook type answers, but I will help you break it down and give you certain terms or keywords that will help you remember the meaning of those words or phrases. So as you prepare, I like to tell my students, right, don't sit there and try to cram the definition of these words. Understand what they mean and kind of help yourself see how you can put those words into sentences. For example, if I was to say, oh, I'm a broker in Illinois, I don't have to give you the textbook definition for what that means, but you generally have an idea of the meaning. So if you see the word in a question, you know what it means. Another example, there's a word in my other video, testate. Testate means to die with a will. Now, the exam may not necessarily ask you what is the definition of testate, right? But they would use it in a sentence. And you're supposed to understand when they say a man dies testate, what that means, all right? So that's kind of where I'm coming from in this approach. And I mean, it helps me pass. It's helped some of my other students pass. So I hope that it helps you pass too. All right, so without further ado, let's jump in to the material. First, what is sponsoring broker? Sponsoring broker, think of the owner of the business. All right, so this is a person who hires or sponsors agents, so brokers, managing brokers, and residential leasing agents. For example, I work for a brokerage, so when I'm filling out paperwork, the brokerage is my sponsoring broker. Broker. A broker is an individual or a business entity that for compensation or for the expectation of compensation is helping someone else in a real estate transaction. So you're either helping them buy, sell, or lease. Now, the definition, this is from our real estate license law. It kind of encompasses everything. So you're doing this in person or in media format, your intention to get paid or expecting to get paid directly or indirectly. All right. So it covers all the bases for services for which a real estate license is required. So those services are helping someone buy, sell, negotiate, advertise, right, when you're expecting compensation. Managing broker. This is a broker who has taken additional classes, all right, and taken the exam, and then you apply for the managing broker license. You are then able to manage an office for a sponsoring broker. You don't have to, but you can when you have this managing broker license. With this managing broker license, you can also then open your own brokerage and be your own self sponsored agent. So you can be your own sponsoring broker. The designated managing broker is the person who is actually in the role of a manager, the person who has been assigned or appointed by the sponsoring broker to manage that brokerage, that real estate company. Residential leasing agent. Now, as you can see, it's residential. All right, and this is a leasing agent. So this means they can only lease residential property. You can only lease residential property, and they can help collect rents. They can help find tenants. They can put tenants in, negotiate leases, help with turning over the property, old person going out, new person coming in. But again, only for residential real estate. The Real Estate License Act of 2000, this is the law that we practice under, right? This is a state law. And it was created to protect members of the general public. So why do we have these laws? To protect the public from fraud, incompetence, and such in real estate transactions. It was amended, so created in 2000 and then amended in 2010 and also in 2019. IDFPR. IDFPR is the Illinois Department of Financial and Professional Regulation. You will become very familiar with IDFPR because this is where we get our licenses. So we renew our licenses. This is where if you ever violate the law, you could get called up by IDFPR to be investigated. All right. So they are the ones that are essentially enforcing and administering the Illinois Real Estate License Act of 2000. 120 hours, the number of hours that you need to be a full broker, all right? So Illinois requires 120 hours, but they break it up into two chunks. Pre-licensing, 75 hours, post-license, 45 hours. If you're currently taking your pre-license, you're doing the 75. After you get your license, you're required to complete the 45, and then together you have 125. You're required to complete the 45 before your first renewal, but depending on when you get your license, there is some leeway for that. 165 hours. This is the number of instruction hours needed to become a managing broker, to get the manager broker license. So it counts your pre-license for your broker license, counts the post-license as well, and then you take an additional 45 hours managing broker course. 12 hours. This is the number of continuing education hours required to renew your broker license. And we renew every 2 years. 24 hours. This is the number of hours required for a managing broker to complete in terms of continuing education hours before they can renew their license. 12 for the broker license, 24 for the managing broker license. And also, you have to complete this before you renew, so every 2 years. So question for you guys, and this is a bonus question. Let me know in the comments, when is the broker license renewed and when is the managing broker license renewed? All right, so when is a broker license renewed? When is a managing broker license renewed? Let me know in the comments from your studying and I'll leave the answer in there as well. Brokerage, just think of it as the office. This is where we bring people together, buyers and sellers, landlords and tenants. Okay, so we bring together the parties that are in the real estate transaction. Agency. Agency, think relationship. This is the relationship you have with the person that you're working for. In real estate, agency is the relationship you have as an agent with your client. So either the buyer, seller, landlord, or tenant. All right, so agency relationship between the principal. So the principal is the client, and then the agent is the other party. All right, and you're authorized to perform certain tasks for them as their agent. Implied agency. This is one way agency is created. If you look at the word they're implied, it's through your actions. So when you're doing certain things where you are creating agency, it's not stated, all right? But your actions or your deeds could then show that you are representing someone as their agent. Expressed agency. This is another way agency is created. But in this situation, we are expressing, we are stating either in writing or orally that we have an agency relationship. Okay, so implied, expressed through your actions, through words, either on paper or from your mouth. Designated agent. A designated agent is the licensee or the broker who is authorized by the sponsoring broker to act as the agent of a particular principal, a particular client. So think of yourself as the designated agent. Dual agency. Dual agency occurs when you are representing both the buyer and the seller in the same transaction, right? So buyer, seller, same transaction. It is legal in Illinois only if it is disclosed in writing to all parties involved. Undisclosed dual agency in Illinois is illegal. So question, is dual agency legal in Illinois? The answer is yes, as long as it is disclosed in writing to everyone who is involved. The listing agreement is the employment contract between the sponsoring broker and the principal, the seller. The exclusive right to sell listing agreement is one where this seller is only working with one broker, and that sponsoring broker gets paid a commission regardless of who sells the property. So exclusive rights to sell. You have an exclusive right as a broker to sell this property, and then you get paid once this property sells. Exclusive agency listing agreement. This is another type of listing agreement. It is exclusive, meaning the seller is only working with you, right? They're not contracting with other sponsoring brokers. So just one brokerage that the seller is working with. However, the broker only gets paid if the home sells to someone that you introduce to the property. Meaning if the seller finds their own buyer, maybe on Facebook, wherever, and sells directly to them, you don't get compensated. Open listing agreement. This is not an exclusive agreement. This is one whereby the seller can choose to work with as many brokers as they want. And essentially all they're saying is, I will pay the person who brings me a buyer. Net listing. This listing agreement is based on the net price that the seller gets after the sale. So for example, a seller says, okay, at the end of the sale, I want to at least walk away with $50,000, okay? We're conservative, 50,000 bucks. Now, whatever it sells for, if there's anything over and above that 50, it becomes a commission of the agent that worked with this seller. Now, this is legal in Illinois, but it is frowned upon because there is room for fraud. Okay. So you could lie to a seller and say, well, at least I can get you 50,000 for this house, knowing full well that this property will sell for way more and your commission will be way higher. Buyer agency agreement. Here we're working with a buyer, and this is the employment contract that the buyer has with the sponsoring broker. So in this situation, the buyer is the principal and the sponsor broker is the agent. Exclusive buyer agency agreement. Again, this is exclusive. So this buyer is only working with one broker, one agent, right? Now, this buyer is legally obligated to pay the brokerage or the broker exclusive buyer agency agreement. This again is exclusive, so the buyer is only working with one broker, and the buyer is obligated to pay this broker a commission regardless of who finds the property that the buyer purchases. It is also sometimes called the exclusive right to represent. So kind of like the exclusive right to sell, this is the exclusive right to represent. And the broker gets paid regardless of how this property is found. Exclusive agency, buyer agency agreement. This is similar to the exclusive agency listing agreement. Here, exclusive, the buyer is only working with one agent or one broker, and that broker only gets compensated if they help this buyer find a home. If the buyer finds a home on their own, no compensation is made to the broker. open buyer agency agreement. This is not exclusive. The buyer reserves a right to work with any broker that they want and will compensate the broker who helps them find the home that they ultimately purchase. Contemporaneous offers. With contemporaneous offers, you may be working with multiple buyers who are interested in the same property. Like they have the same price range, they're looking in the same neighborhood. So you show one a house, you show the other the same house. They both like it. They both want to make an offer. And you're the one representing both of them. Now, that offer you're about to make is called a contemporaneous offer. So for a contemporaneous offer, you have two or more buyers who are interested in one property, and you're about to make an offer on that property. Question, can you do it? The answer is yes. As long as all parties are aware, and again, it must be in writing. So it's disclosed to all parties in writing saying, yes, I am representing this guy and this lady, whoever they are, right? And those people I'm representing will have to sign a paper that says, yes, we know that you are representing both of us and we're okay with it. Price fixing. This is where multiple real estate companies come together and decide on the price that they will charge, essentially eliminating an open and free market. As your own brokerage, you could decide what your fees are, but it becomes a problem. It becomes antitrust, an antitrust violation when multiple companies are coming together to kind of set the price. For example, if Walmart and Target get together and say, okay, bread is going to be $4 regardless of where you are. Now that's price fixing, and that'll be an antitrust violation. Group boycotting. This again is where two or more companies, right? So this is outside of just one company with all these antitrust violations. Two or more companies are coming together and saying, all right, we don't like this other company and we're not going to do business with them, right? So you as an individual, you could choose, I'm not going to go to XYZ to do business because of what they did to me in the past. But when I go get a group of other real estate companies together, and now we are deciding to run this person out of business by boycotting them, that's an antitrust violation. Tie-in agreements. A tie-in agreement, also an antitrust violation, is one where you're doing one action only if the other action is also done. For example, I will only help you buy a house if you are going to hire me to sell your house too. If you don't hire me to sell your house, I'm not going to help you buy a house. Allocation of customers or markets. This again is where real estate companies are coming together and kind of partitioning the market and saying, okay, ABC Realty works here, XYZ Realty works here, 123 Realty works here. You cannot cross these boundaries. So everyone who lives here has to work with ABC Realty. Everyone who lives here has to work with XYZ Realty. And everyone who lives here has to work with 123 Realty. All right, so we can't do that. Companies can decide, hey, we only do luxury. And then they cater to luxury clients, right? That's okay to do. However, again, with multiple companies, right? You're noticing the term here. So I'm speaking plural, companies are coming together. And that's when it becomes a problem. So with that, we've come to the end of our vocabulary for today. I hope this was very beneficial to you. Like I said earlier, this is a video, so you can pause, go back, review certain things that you need to review so that you're sure that you understand the terminology. Be sure to leave me a question in the comments below if you need more clarification on some of these other topics. And jump onto this next one, as I promised in the beginning. This is more vocabulary for you. So jump in there and continue to study. First, let me know if you guys need more help. Let me know if there are topics you also want me to cover, and I'll be glad to do so. Until next time, be well and best wishes as you prepare for the exam.